like a river, attendeth my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast heard
I'm not afraid to die. Good morning. It's great that you're with us today. I pray that you're just going to have a real sense of God's presence, of His Spirit. You're going to hear in your heart Him speaking to you. I just want to encourage you wherever you are. I just want to encourage you to stand up. We're going to worship God in a moment. And I know with online church at the moment, we do it from where our living rooms or our dining rooms or wherever we're sat down, and that's great. But I've stood up this morning. I just want to encourage you to stand up, and it's something in changing our posture, in standing up, standing before God, and to just come to His presence. So let's just pray together, shall we? Father, I just want to thank you for today. I want to thank you for this new day and this new opportunity to praise you and to worship you. And I just ask now for every person in every home, every person that's watching or listening to this online, that your Spirit would just fall upon them, and they would just have a real sense of you, something new of you today. And as we worship you, as we lift our hearts, we lift our voices, we welcome your Spirit, your presence to be amongst us. So just lead us today, we pray, and through your Son Jesus we ask. Amen. Amen, church. And we're gonna sing that song. We've been singing it every week during this water walking series. It's Raise a Hallelujah. It talks about we're going to sing in the middle of the storm. We're going to praise God with everything that we are. So I just want to encourage you, wherever you are, to just raise your voice and to worship God this morning. Yeah, just praise His wonderful, His holy name today. As we sing, we'll raise a hallelujah. Bless you, church.
I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah.
Gideon here again. Yeah, you know, I was thinking, I remembered what Joshua said. He was saying how God had said to him, never be afraid or discouraged because the Lord would always be with him. And, you know, sometimes I thought, is that true? Oh, but I tell you what, some of the things that have just happened to me, wow. Well, because first of all, you know, I'd gone out, I'd smashed those poles down and no one hurt me. So, well, I knew God was with me, but I wanted to be sure. So I came out one night and I put down my blanket on the floor and I said, God, I just want to be sure that you're with me. So if in the morning My blanket is wet, and everything else is dry. No dew anywhere. Just on my blanket. Then I'll know it's you, and you're with me. And in the morning, I went out, and it was all dry everywhere, except my blanket that was wet. And then I thought, is God really with me? So I said, God, I hope you don't mind if just once more, I put out my blanket, and in the morning, can that be dry, and it be dew everywhere else? And so I put it out, and in the morning, it was dry. It was amazing. And yeah, I thought, God is with me. And by then I'd called all the armies to gather round, and there was 32,000 of us. Wow. Well, we're so strong, and now I know God's with us as well, because it was brilliant. And then God said to me, right, you've got too many people. Sorry? You've got too many in your army. I was like, really? Really? He said, yeah, anyone who's scared, tell them to go home. So I looked and said, anyone who's scared, none of you are scared, are you? No? No, of course you wouldn't be scared. Anyone who's scared can go home. What, you're... 22,000 of them left. I was left with 10,000. But God was still with me. And then God said, no, you've got 10,000. That's still too many. Really? He said, yeah, go down to the river. So we went down to the river. And he said, get everyone to take a drink. So I did. And he said, everyone that bends all the way down and laps it up straight from the river, tell them to go home. But everyone who scoops it up in their hands and drinks it, they can stay. I thought, okay. Not many of them would bend all the way down and lap it up straight from the river.
What are you all doing? What are you all...
9,700 of them did that. 300 of them didn't. So my army was now down to 300. I had 32,000. I was strong. I was now got 300. But God's with me. Is he? God, are you with me? God then said, well, why don't you go down and listen to what they're saying, the enemy in that camp. So I went down. They were all asleep. It was night time. Shh, we've got to be careful. Shh. We went down and we listened. We listened to what they said. They'd had a dream that our army, well, the God of our army, had rolled this massive boulder, massive, and squashed their whole camp. Wow. I knew then that God was with us. And we got everyone with a jar and a light inside the jar. And then we went down and we smashed the jars and we blew trumpets. And they all panicked and ran off. And God won this battle. What was that Joshua said? Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Yeah. My name's Gideon, and I can tell you that Joshua knew what he was talking about. There is no need to be afraid, because our God is with us. Let's pray together. Father God, as we go into this new week, help us not to be afraid. Help us to put our trust in you. Help us to put our trust in you if we feel anxious, if we're frustrated, if we're isolated, if we're feeling down. Lord, help us to put our trust in you. And Lord, we continue to pray for all those who are mourning, all those who are concerned for loved ones, all those who are working to care for those who are suffering. Lord, we lift them up to you. And we thank you that you are always with us. Amen. This Sunday is the last day before we begin our 21 days of prayer and fasting. Wayne will be talking about that in his sermon coming up. But we also want to introduce a new email, 21days@coshenbaptist.org. If while you're praying, if while you're fasting, God says something to you, we would love to know, because we would love to sense whether God is saying something to us as a community. So please, whatever God is putting on your heart, please let us know. Just simply sending an email to this address. Thanks very much.
Well, good morning again. It's lovely. I hope you're feeling God's presence in this service today. I'm excited about where we are today as we come to the end of a mini series, but also as we start our 21 days of prayer and fasting tomorrow. So church, is an exciting time to be part of CBC at the moment. A couple of weeks ago, I was walking our dog, and it was early morning, and I was in a park just at the end of our road, and I was just walking the dog, and she was running back and forth, and we were having a good time. And all of a sudden, before I know it, I'm on the floor. I'm flat on my face, and it has completely taken the wind out of my sails. And what's happened is Nala is on a long lead, and she's run, and she's chased another dog, and it's caught me off guard, and I've ended up flat on my face. Now, there was a couple of reasons that my dog pulled me over. Firstly, when she sees another dog, it's like, oh my gosh, I've never seen one of those before, and I her tail, and she's just got to play, and she just goes. It's a major distraction, and she goes, and she just wants to play with that other dog. She'll do all she can to get to them. The second reason is we've realized that she's got a bit older. She doesn't look it, but she's actually really strong, and you know, I'm a big bloke, and if she can pull me over, you know, if I've been caught off guard, wow. You know, she's a strong dog, and she's a determined dog as well. And the third reason is we're still training her. You know, she's got a lot to learn, and she doesn't always do what we tell her to do or what she's supposed to do. But by far the main reason my dog pulled me over is because I took my eye off her. You see, I was looking the other way. If I'd been watching her when she ran, I could have taken the strain a little bit, and I could have planted my feet, I could have called her, I could have pulled her back, and she would not have pulled me over. But because I was just like this, I was looking the other way, she was behind me, I didn't feel her pulling until the lead tightened, and then it just caught me. And I went down quickly with a thump, I have to tell you. I was aching for a few days. I'd cut my hand a little bit, I hurt my knee, but more than that, I was cross at myself for taking my eyes, my attention off her. Today in the sermon, we're kind of doing two things. As I just said, we're finishing our short mini series, Water Walking, but we're also going to dovetail, we're going to link this to our 21 days of prayer, which starts tomorrow. And as we come to the end of this story, this account from Matthew's gospel, we're at the point in the story where Peter takes his eyes off Jesus and he sinks and he falls into the water and Jesus grabs him and lifts him up. You see, there are for all of us times, are there not, where we take our eye off the ball, we take our eyes off things. Have you ever had that moment where you're driving and somewhere and suddenly you realize you can't recall the last 5 minutes or the last 20 minutes of your drive or how you got there because you haven't been paying full attention to what's going on around you. And so you draw your attention back to the road. As a family, when we're in a car, we play yellow car. I'm sure you've played it. You may choose other colors, but yellows, I think, are the hardest to spot. And so whenever we see a yellow car, somebody shouts, "Yellow car, no returns." And you know, "Oh, I didn't see that one." And you have to have your attention on what's around you. It's hard to do when you're driving because your attention needs to be on the road, but you need to also look out for yellow cars as well. Or do you get to the end of the day and you struggle to think, what on earth have I done with my day? My attention has been elsewhere. Or you send your kids upstairs for some reason and an hour later you think, it's gone quiet. I haven't seen the kids. I'd completely forgotten about the kids. You might have had kids for years and you've just forgotten that you have kids because it's quiet upstairs. It's not just me, is it, that does all of these things? Because you see, there are moments in life when we shift our attention to something and we find that there are consequences to that. But there is a far more serious situation going on in our lives. For there are moments and seasons when we shift our attention off Jesus. And when that happens, the consequences can be serious. But we do it. As human beings, we find ourselves in situations in life and in seasons in life, and our actions show that we've taken our attention off Jesus, as Peter did, and we become frightened. I'm going to read the whole of the story from Matthew to us again, as it's the last in the series this morning. We read, "As soon as the people were fed, Jesus told his disciples to get into their boat and go to the other side of the lake, where he stayed behind to dismiss the people. After the crowds dispersed, Jesus went up to the hills to pray, and as night fell, he was there praying alone with God. But the disciples, who were now in the middle of the lake, ran into trouble, for their boat was tossed about by the high winds and heavy seas. At about 4 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came to them walking on the waves. When the disciples saw him walking on top of the water, they were terrified and screamed, 'A ghost!' Then Jesus said, 'Be brave and don't be afraid. I am here.' Peter shouted, 'Lord, if it's really you, then have me join you on the water.' 'Come and join me,' Jesus replied. So Peter stepped out onto the water and began to walk towards Jesus. But when he realized how high the waves were, he became frightened and started to sink. 'Save me, Lord,' he cried out. Jesus immediately stretched out his hand and lifted him up and said, 'What little faith you have. Why would you let doubt win?' And the very moment they both stepped into the boat, the raging wind ceased. Then all the disciples crouched down before him and worshipped Jesus. They said in adoration, 'You are truly the Son of God.'" You know, friends, this must have been an amazing moment. Jesus has called Peter. He steps out of the boat and he walks on water. As Jerry said a couple of weeks ago, we don't know how far Peter walked. It doesn't matter. He walked on water. Have you physically done that? I don't think I haven't, you know. And then something changed, didn't it? For he noticed what was around him. He noticed where he was and what he was doing, and he got frightened. And we can be doing well in life. We can be in good relationship with Jesus. We're walking with him, and then something changes. Maybe we notice what's going on around us, and for some reason it starts to scare us. And you see, Peter, seeing how high the waves were, he did something. He took his eye off Jesus. You know, he was doing okay. He was doing more than okay. He was walking on water, for goodness sake. And then as he allows the storm around him to take front and center, to become the main thing in his moment, it takes him away from Jesus and he sinks into the water. And as he does, he falls away from Jesus. You see, up to that point, it was okay. He was doing something amazing, but he was looking to Jesus. Now, if you back up a little bit in the story, we read that as the disciples were out on the lake, they ran into trouble. We know this means they found themselves in the middle of a storm that was simply too much for them to handle. It was too strong for them. And it was in the middle of the storm that they see Jesus. You see, it's interesting that they ran into trouble, because that says to me that Peter was frightened before he walked on water. The Bible has told us that they ran into trouble. It was serious trouble, trouble that they thought they might die. So Peter would have been frightened before he walked on water, before when he's walking on water, he sees the waves. And you know, when you run into trouble, it disturbs you, it throws you off guard, it frightens you. But as soon as Peter sees Jesus, he breathes a sigh of relief. He is still being thrown about by this storm, but it's as if then he doesn't notice it because he sees Jesus. So when Jesus calls him over the side of the boat, he's well up for it. He's running on adrenaline, for he sees Jesus. But then only a moment or two later, things shift. And it's because he shifts. And I don't know if this says anything to you, but it really speaks to me. You see, there can be times in life when we run into trouble. And then in that trouble, we see Jesus, and suddenly, whew, it's all okay again. And we're okay for a moment or two. We're okay for a little while. But then we see the trouble again. And we get frightened and we sink because we take our focus off Jesus. And it's as if we can go through life, it feels like we're on a pendulum, swaying from being okay, we're keeping our eyes on Jesus, all is well. And then, oh heck, we see the trouble again. We see the storm and we swing the other way again as we take our eyes off Jesus. And friends, we get frightened. And the difference between being in this side of the pendulum where we're with Jesus and we're walking on water, and being on this side of the pendulum when we see the trouble and we're frightened, the difference is we take our eyes off Jesus. And it's a strange thing for Peter in this story, because you would think if he was walking on water, can you just let that sink in a moment? You know, he's walking on water. He's defying all science. You know, he is walking, a grown man is walking on water. You would think everything would be okay. He would be fine. He would do that for hours. But it wasn't, and because he took his eyes off Jesus. And you see, we're no different. We can be right in the middle of the water walking experience. And you know, it's almost as if we think, in that moment, we see something else and we think, this is madness. Jesus possibly can't do this for me. He can't be that powerful. He can't bring the miracle. And I know it's crazy, right? Because we get afraid and allow this thought to grow right in the middle of the experience of the miracle. It's as if Peter sees himself walking on water and thinks, this is wonderful. But then he thinks, no, this can't be wonderful. This is unbelievable. This can't be happening. This something is wrong. There's no way Jesus could do this. And it's that thought process of doubting Jesus that as he's in the middle of the act, that is him turning away from Jesus. And in that moment, he sinks. I hope you're with me this morning, because I want us to see something powerful today. And it's this, you know, the reason we can walk on water is not only because we never take our eyes off Jesus, It's because Jesus never takes his eyes off us. Let me say that again. The reason we walk on water is not only because we never take our eyes off Jesus. It's because Jesus never takes his eyes off us. And when we grasp that, you know, we ask ourselves, what are we then afraid of? Because if Jesus never takes his eyes off us, then there is nothing with Jesus we cannot do, we cannot accomplish. As we said, the sermon is the last in our mini-series, but it's also a lead into our 21 days of prayer and fasting, which I'm really excited about. And it starts tomorrow. And I'm so excited about the next 3 weeks. Now, if you've been listening over the past couple of weeks, you will know that the theme for our 21 days is return to me. And this 21 days of prayer and fasting is making us choose to put our eyes on Jesus, because his eye is on us. And you see, returning to Jesus can mean a whole lot of things. You may be someone who has known Jesus for a long time, but you've walked away from him. And so you need to return, and this is an opportunity to return to him. Maybe you have a faith, but you're in a rut. You've kind of become stuck. You've hit a ceiling, as it were, and returning to him is breaking through that ceiling to experience more of him. You may be doing well in your walk with God, but you simply want to go deeper. Well, returning to Jesus can be a way of diving deeper in your relationship with him. Returning to Jesus can and will have lots of different meanings for us, but it's something that is common to all of what this may mean for us for the next 21 days. For it to become real, we have to choose to return. You have to choose to turn your gaze, to turn your focus, to turn your eye, to turn your attention to Jesus. You know, notice in Matthew we read, Jesus immediately stretched out his hand and lifted him up. This is after Peter sank, and said, what little faith you have, why would you let doubt win? Did you see it? Jesus said the whole reason Peter fell away from Jesus when he said, why would you let doubt win? Jesus didn't say, why do you have doubt? Jesus knows that we doubt. Jesus knows that we struggle. He said, why did you let it win? You know, Jesus understood that we have those doubts, but he asks us today, why would you let it win by taking your eyes off me? You know, as I was preparing this sermon, I started to just ponder. And I was wondering, I wonder if Jesus doubts me. I don't know if he does. Maybe some of you thinking, I hadn't thought of that. Oh, is that right? Can Jesus doubt us? I don't know if Jesus doubts me, but what I do know is that he never lets any doubt that he may have about me win, because he never takes his eyes off me. So he knows, he's championing me. He knows that if I stay with him, I could always do it. I can always do whatever it is that he lays before me, because he never takes his eyes off me. You know, our 21 days of prayer and fasting is, I believe, an opportunity to not let the doubt about what Jesus can accomplish in our lives and in CBC win. During the next 21 days, I truly believe your relationship with Jesus is going to be deepened. You may find that you experience some form of clarity, some form of revelation throughout it, and you'll be the richer for it. For there's always more to our relationship with Jesus, but you've got to keep your attention on him. You mustn't let any doubt win. And the reason we'll experience more is because while there is no more to us that Jesus needs to know, he knows it all, there is always more to Jesus that we need to know. Now, just a word of encouragement. Notice that when Peter fell, Jesus reached out and lifted him up immediately. And that is it's a confirmation that Jesus had his eyes on him. Because if Jesus didn't have his eyes on him, if Jesus had been looking elsewhere when Peter fell down and Peter sunk, you know, he would have turned around, where's he gone? But because he was intently watching him, as soon as Peter fell, bam, he could reach out and pick him up. He knew exactly where Peter was. And friends, the next 21 days is certainly not so you can be a perfect follower of Jesus. It's not saying you're never going to fall again. But when you do, know that Jesus is right there, ready to pick you back up. But for us, choosing to return to Jesus, whatever that may mean for us as individuals, means choosing him over the doubts that creep into our lives. You know, walking on water, just by nature of what it sounds like, walking on water is never easy. If anything, water on walking is not something that should happen, but with Jesus it does. And when we do the impossible with him, when we choose to not let fear or doubt or unbelief or negativity take hold, our relationship with Jesus goes that little bit deeper each time. And as one of your pastors, you know, that, and I know Simon feels the same, all we want to do, our heart is that your relationship with Jesus would go deeper. That you would know more about him today than you knew about him yesterday. That you would realize that as you go through life, whatever it is that you're going through, whether it's a mountaintop experience or whether it's a valley low, whatever it is that you're going through, Jesus has got his eyes on you. Jesus will never take his eyes off you. And that should, that needs to encourage us. It needs to push us to keep our eyes firmly fixed on him. You know, I don't know what all of this says to you. You know, I don't know if you've realized before that you can only accomplish what you do because Jesus never takes his eyes off you. I just want to keep saying that, you know, church, that really has spoken to me. You know, Jesus, the only reason Peter did it was not just because he kept his eyes on Jesus, but because Jesus never took his eyes off him. And whatever you're going through in life, whatever you sense that Jesus has for you in your present and in your future, you know, you can accomplish great things. You know, as you come to this 21 days of prayer and fasting, as you're looking for revelation, as you're looking for clarity, Jesus can give you so much. He can broaden your viewpoint. He can open your eyes. He can open your heart to wonderful things that you've never, ever seen before. And it's not just because your eyes are firmly fixed on him, as important as that is, but it's because his eyes are fixed on you and you're just looking intently at each other. Now, I don't know where you are when it comes to the idea of a 21-day prayer and fast. For many people, the idea of a fast is a bit too much and you might be in that camp. You know, maybe you think it's an outdated thing to do. Maybe you think it's for those who are amazing Christians. Maybe you think it's just for Christian leaders. But taking part in a fast for you, maybe you get stepping over the side of the boat, keeping your eyes on Jesus, walking on water and realizing his eyes are on you. And so as we think about that, I also just want to dovetail and add some basic and brief teaching on fasting at this point so that you're fully equipped to take part. And you see, the goal of fasting is to draw near to God. Biblical fasting always has to do with eliminating distractions for a spiritual purpose. It hits the reset button of our soul, as I said last week, and renews us from the inside out. It also enables us to celebrate the goodness and mercy of God, and it prepares our hearts for all the amazing, all the great things that God wants to bring into our lives. As I said last week, remember your personal fast, it needs to present a level of challenge, but it's very important as you do that, as you choose what it's going to be, that you know your body, your options, and most importantly, you seek God in prayer and follow what the Holy Spirit leads you to do. Now, what is a fast? There are four different types of fasts, and I'm going to quickly run through them this morning. Firstly, there's the complete fast. That it kind of says what it does on the tin. You know, it doesn't need massive amount of explanation. You give up all food. That's basically it. You only have liquid, normally water or some juice, and you don't eat food. You abstain from all food for 21 days. Now, you need to know you're physically able to do that. Often when people are looking at a longer fast like that, they lead up to it. So for a few months before, they might start by having one day where they don't have food. They might do that for a month, and then they do 2 days, and they slowly start to build up to that. A complete fast needs like to be something that God calls you to, but I especially think that's true when it's a complete fast for a long period of time. So that's the first type of fast, a complete fast. Then there's a selective fast. This type of fast involves removing certain elements from your diet. One example of a selective fast is the Daniel fast, during which you remove meats, sweets and bread from your diet. You consume water, juice for fluids, and fruit and vegetables for food. You know, Daniel in the Bible did this for 21 days. That's where a Daniel fast comes from. But you may choose in a selective fast to remove tea and coffee or caffeine or crisps or chocolate or whatever it is that gives you an element of challenge. If it's something that you don't eat very often, don't say I'm going to remove that. You know, if you're somebody that I need my cup of tea, you know, maybe that is something that it's right that you remove from your diet in a selective fast. Then there's a partial fast, sometimes called the Jewish fast. It sees you not having any food in the morning or the afternoon, and then just an evening meal. And then there's a soul fast. This fast is a great option if you don't have a lot of experience of fasting from food and it freaks you out a little bit, or you have health issues that prevent you from fasting food, or if you just wish to refocus certain areas of your life that are out of balance. For example, you might want to stop using social media or watching television for the duration of the fast, and then carefully bring that element back into your life in healthy doses at the conclusion of the fast. You know, soul fast is a great fast. You know, I've heard a number of people in recent months say to me, oh, I'm always looking on my phone. I can, while hours away on Netflix or social media, or, you know, which is Facebook and Instagram and all of those things. Well, maybe for 21 days, just remove it from your diet, remove it from your life, and allow God to speak to you about that. So you've got the complete fast, the selective fast, the partial fast, and the soul fast. And so you need to choose which type of fast you're going to do, and then pray to God to help you as you do this. You know, fasting is one of the oldest and most prevalent spiritual practices in the Bible. Great leaders in the Bible fasted routinely, including Moses, David, Jeremiah, Isaiah, John the Baptist, Jesus, and the disciples. In Matthew 6, 16, Jesus addresses fasting when he tells the disciples, when you fast. Notice he didn't say, if you fast, if you can be bothered, if it's something that you're interested in. You know, he says, when you fast. There's an assumption that fasting will be part of our lives. And it's, though fasting is assumed, it's not required. You don't have to do it. You know, but the wonderful thing about fasting is it's an invitation. We get to do it. It's not a rule and a regulation. We choose to do it. And like all intentional spiritual practices, fasting, you know, please, friends, over the next 21 days, don't allow it to become legalistic. You know, don't beat yourself up if you just, oh, heck, I looked on my phone, or, oh, I had a chocolate bar and I'd given up. You know, just start again. You know, we're not earning approval from God through fasting. We're not doing it so that God's going to love us more. That's impossible. He already does. Rather, we're simply doing it to draw closer to God, and we're returning to Jesus. We're keeping our attention on Jesus and realizing that Jesus's attention is on us. And so in the context of today's message, are you in? You know, if not, what are you afraid of? What is stopping you taking part in this fast for the next 21 days? What is stopping you walking on the water? You may be thinking, I don't think anything will change. Well, you won't know if you don't try. So don't allow doubt to win, but just get on board with this 21 days of prayer and fasting. You know, where in your life, where in your walk with Jesus, are you letting doubt win? Allow this time to give you clarity as you draw closer to him. What do you sense in your spirit God is saying to you, but you doubt he can work out all the practical details because they seem too big for you? Draw close to him. Get revelation from him during these 21 days. Friends, this is an exciting water walking moment that we're about to take part in together. Don't let it pass you by. And so I just want to draw this sermon to a close by saying, in CBC's online prayer time last Monday, Monday just gone, we thought about the story in the Old Testament where Pharaoh and the Egyptians, with all of this, all of their amazing chariots and their resources, are chasing after the Israelites. And Moses and the Israelites are at the banks of the Red Sea. And there seems to be no way out. They're stuck. They know what's coming behind them. And there's nowhere for them to turn. And they're kind of, oh my gosh, what on earth is going to happen now? And in that moment, Moses senses in his spirit to just say to them, you only need to be still. What? Are you mad, man? We need to strategize. We need to find a way out. We need to run around and panic. No. You only need to be still. It was in the staying still that God revealed their next steps, which was a miracle as the Red Sea parted and they walked through. I think fasting put together with prayer is a bit like choosing to be still. And as you fast and pray, you allow yourself to return to Jesus. You allow yourself to see again that his attention is on you. Not worrying about what it will do, but being more interested in just knowing Jesus more through it. So don't look at the waves of skepticism, the waves of it's not me, the waves of negativity, the waves of I'm not that sort of a Christian, the waves of disbelief, but instead just step out of the boat and choose to not allow doubt to win. So I'm inviting you to choose a fast that is right for you. Don't worry about what others are doing. Join together online at one or all of the following times: Sunday at 7 o'clock, Tuesday at 8 p.m., Thursday at 12 noon, Friday at 7 a.m., Saturday at 9 in the morning. That's an all-age prayer, but it's open to everyone, whoever you are, whatever age, that is for you as well. It's not just families with children, and allow yourself to choose to be still as you return to Jesus. Also, look out in your email for short reflection and prayer every day. We won't get it on a Sunday because we'd be meeting online like this on a Sunday, but Monday through the Saturday, you'll get an email that's a short reflection that leads us for that theme for the day. You know, we are stronger together and we are better when we grow together, church. And so I would simply ask you to not let doubt win and choose to walk on water together. We are in an important time. The pandemic has brought new challenges, but also wonderful opportunities that God wants to use for good. And when this pandemic has passed, when the waves have died down, we can either go back to what we knew, what we feel safe and comfortable with, or we can go forward into the new things of Jesus. You know, going forward requires us together to keep looking to Jesus, to keep realizing that his eyes are firmly fixed on us, to not let in doubt win. And this 21-day prayer and fast is a powerful way to do that. You see, going back requires you to keep your attention on what you know. It actually requires you to keep your attention on the waves and the winds around you. Going forward requires you to keep your eyes on Jesus and to see his eyes are on you. For you, friends, which one will it be? Let's pray together. Father, on the eve of our 21 days of prayer and fasting, I just want to ask right now that you will pour out your Spirit upon all who are watching, all who are listening, all who are going to take part in this in powerful ways. Just give us a renewed enthusiasm, a renewed sense of you being with us, Father. But I just pray for all those right now who feel they have sunk. May they experience the hand of Jesus reaching out and grabbing them, Father. For all who are struggling, for all who have taken their eyes off you, may we just choose to return. May we choose to keep up, to turn our eyes, to turn our attention back on you, to see that your attention is firmly on us. And may we not let doubt win. Thank you, Father, that you know we have doubts. Thank you that you know we have struggles. But with your help, with your power, with your love, with your grace, with your mercy, we can choose to not let it win. And I just want to praise you for that. And I just ask that you will speak that into the hearts, into the lives of everybody that is gathering today, that everybody that is gathering for these next 21 days of prayer and fasting. And I just pray that you will give clarity, that you'll give revelation, that you will give comfort, that you will give assurance, that you will just draw near to people over these next 3 weeks. Father, thank you for this opportunity, and we bless you for it, and we praise you for it, and we worship you for it, and we thank you. Yeah. Just lead us, speak to us powerfully. May we see more of you over these next 3 weeks. Yeah, to your Son Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to close our time together as Meg leads us in the song Dancing on the Waves. It seems very apt, doesn't it, for the sermon, the series that we've been doing. It may be new to you, but you know what? It was new to me until Wednesday, until this week. It's a great song, and there's some words in it that really speak to me. And it says, don't be afraid, I am your strength. We'll be walking on the water, dancing on the waves. Isn't that wonderful? Don't be afraid, I am your strength. We'll be walking on the water, dancing on the waves. Friends, as we sing this song, I want to encourage you to stand. Don't sit there, don't slouch. If you're able, I just want to encourage you to stand up as we did this morning. Just stand up and worship God. If you don't know the song, if you don't know the words, just allow it to wash over you, to strengthen, to encourage you, and to sing it in your spirit. Friends, keep your eyes on Jesus and dance on the waves this morning. Bless you. Bless you. Take care. Been running
Thank you for joining us today, and we thank God that although we can't meet physically, most of us have the technology to virtually meet and see each other. God is with us wherever we are, and he meets us at our point of need. So have a good week, and I look forward to joining with you all for the 21 days of prayer and fasting starting tomorrow. So I just finish with a short prayer. Loving God, thank you for hearing our prayers, for feeding us with your word, and encouraging us in our meeting together. Take us and use us to love and serve you and all people. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Yeah.